So take a moment to consider the physical space that surrounds you. How usable is that space? How usable are the products that you use? How do you even start evaluating the usability of something? Ta-da! The 7 principles of universal design! That's what they're for! They can be used to evaluate the usability of existing designs and can be used during the design process to really help guide the design of spaces and products to being more usable by more people. Let's look at the 7 principles of universal design together. And as we go through these, I want you to be thinking about your own physical space, your home, your office, your car. Think of examples that comply with these principles, and think of examples that, oopsie daisies, violate these principles. The first one is equitable use. The design is useful and marketable to people with diverse abilities. And our classic example here is that staircase with the ramp built in. Intrinsically a part of the design of our staircase, right? So users who are using a walker, a wheelchair, maybe they're pushing a stroller, maybe they're using crutches, maybe they're walking fine with both legs, they're maybe rolling a bicycle, or what else? It could be the UPS guy with a dolly full of packages, right? They're all able to use this space to arrive at the front door of the building. That's up there, right? The entrance is equally safe and equally appealing to all users. That's equitable use. Flexibility in use. The design accommodates a wide range of individual preferences and abilities. So here we see my vegetable peeler again. That's the design that's easy to hold and use for everyone, not just users with arthritis for whom it was originally designed. I'm going to let you come up with some better examples of this one. There are lots. Simple and intuitive use is next. So use that the design is easy to understand, regardless of the user's experience, knowledge, language skills, or current concentration level. So here we see the directions for my daughter's birthday cake that I need to follow tonight to make her birthday cake. So you can see the directions use pictures for the ingredients along the top, pictures of the 3 steps along the left side, and even at the bottom, it's kind of hard to see, but there's different baking pans and times along the bottom. The directions are easy to follow. And then sometimes there are directions that appear to be easy to follow, and they are in theory, but in practice, that step does not yield the desired result, does it? So sometimes the directions that seem simple and intuitive, in fact, cause the most confusion and frustration. Next one, perceptible information. The next time you are crossing the street, you will hear that voice counting down the seconds that you have left to cross. And I want you to think about our class, and I want you to think about this universal design principle of perceptible information. Not only are you seeing the picture of the hand, the digital display of the numbers counting down, but you also hear, and this is important for the visually impaired, the verbal countdown informing the pedestrian how much time is left to cross the street. So that uses the senses of hearing and vision, right? The design communicates necessary information effectively to the user, regardless of ambient conditions or the user's sensory abilities. Okay, what's the next one? Tolerance for error. And Juan Carlos Morales gets credit for this photo. He was a previous student of mine. The design minimizes hazards and the adverse consequences of accidental or unintended actions. So here we see that we see the double-sided key. So a lot of keys have to have a specific vertical orientation. You have to put it in the right way in order for it to work. Not this key. No worries, if you put it in upside down, it will still work. That's a great example of tolerance for error. Thank you, Juan Carlos. Low physical effort. The design can be used efficiently and comfortably and with a minimum of fatigue. So here's that ceiling fan, and you got to go grab the chair and pull the chair over in order to grab at those, in order to be able to reach those little chain pulley things. That is not low physical effort. That's difficult, and that's why, you know, a lot of times we tie on strings or some sort of tassel onto those things, making them easier to reach from the floor level. By design, not low physical effort. Size and space for approach and use. Appropriate size and space is provided for approach, reach, manipulation, and use, regardless of user's body size, posture, or mobility. So what does that mean? Check this out. Look at that store aisle. I can't even imagine trying to push my kid's stroller through that aisle. First of all, they'd be grabbing at the candy left and right. But then, you know, what do I do if someone else comes down the aisle the opposite direction, or I have to turn that corner with my big old stroller? It's not happening. Not enough space to use those aisles. Contrasted with this big, nice, big, wide aisle that allows lots of users, the space that they need to get through the store aisles easily. Okay, that was size and space for approach and use. All right. These principles are the foundation of universal design in the physical world that surrounds us. What about your physical world? So your kitchen, your office, your classrooms, the restaurants that you go to, the stores where you shop. How would they stack up against these principles? Let me know. I want you to share your examples, things that comply with, and things that violate these principles. And I know that you know this already, but I'm going to remind you anyway. Our challenge together in this class is to apply these to the online environment, to website design. Awesomeness! I hope you stay with me this semester.